Welcome back. So in the next session, we'll talk about MVVM. It's actually one of my favorite topics as well. So I'm really interested seeing what Diederik has to say. He's going to be using the new MVVM toolkit from Microsoft. I haven't worked with it yet, so I'm definitely interested. Diederik, the floor is yours. Good luck.
Hey, thank you, Jill. Good evening, everyone. I am Diederik Krols, and in this session, we'll talk about a new NuGet package from Microsoft that contains an MVVM library. As I mentioned, okay, I am Diederik Krols. You have my Twitter handle over there. And on WordPress and on GitHub, I am known as XAMLBrewer. So if you pick your favorite search engine and type XAMLBrewer, you will end up on my blog post and my GitHub repositories. Let's start with a small spoiler alert. The Windows Community Toolkit MVVM library is very useful. It is also very fast. If you are into .NET client development, then I am pretty sure that Windows Community Toolkit MVVM library will work in your apps. And I also have to mention that it is a toolkit, not a fully fledged framework. Let's start with a little introduction on what MVVM actually is supposed to be. Well, MVVM is an architectural pattern where you divide your major code components into three classes. On one hand, you have the model, the entities, the things that represent data and that are probably persisted in a database. And on the other hand, you have the so-called views, the UI components, the pages, the user controls, etc., that host the user interface. And in between, we have the so-called view models that actually make the models bindable to the views. They do the interaction between the models, the properties of the models and the controls in the view. And those three types of components, they talk to each other from model to view model and from view model to view. Everything happens via notifications. Those components supposed to implement the I notify property change set of interfaces. Between the view and the view model, everything happens with data binding. There's data binding for properties, and with commands, there's also data binding for methods. And the only regular code is actually the view model updating the models. Now, sometimes in your application, a lot of different view models may be alive, and those view models are not necessarily aware of each other. And very often they need to exchange information. They have to communicate with each other. That's why most of the MVVM frameworks also provide a so-called messenger or a publish subscription hub. Where view models can send messages through, and view models can register an event handler that will be called back to listen to messages. There is actually a fourth type of component that is very important in a lot of MVVM frameworks, and that is so-called service. A service is a chunk of useful code that does not fall in one of the three other categories, model, view, or view model. And it is supposed to be called from different places, from other services, from view models, from views, from models, etc. Think of things like opening a dialog box, logging, translating items, and things like that. So most of the MVVM frameworks contain logic to locate services and to execute calls against services. MVVM was designed by Microsoft in 2005, specifically for WPF. But it is strange that since that time, there was only one temporary framework in the Microsoft namespace itself, and that was actually the predecessor of Prism. Prism is actually a very popular MVVM framework that grew out of the composite application, composite UI application block from the good old patterns and practices team from Microsoft. It's still one of the most popular MVVM frameworks. There was also Caliburn and Caliburn Micro, and a very useful and very cool framework with which I also have very good experience, as with Prism, by the way. The most popular of the MVVM frameworks is MVVM Lite from Laurent Pignon. And those of you who develop in Xamarin are probably aware of a package called MVVM Cross, which is specialized in doing MVVM for Xamarin. MVVM requires a strong data beta binding engine, so that's why there are a lot of frameworks for XAML, because XAML has or is a very strong data binding engine. But MVVM also grew outside of the XAML namespace and even outside of Microsoft. In the Java framework environment, there is, for example, XTGS by Sencha, which is a very cool MVVM JavaScript framework, but also the old AngularJS and the Angular IO, the current version, are actually MVVM frameworks. And the same is true for Vue.js. So it's not limited to XAML or not limited to Microsoft. If we take a look at the .NET MVVM frameworks, and if you look at the upper right corner, Caliburn Micro and Caliburn, not longer under active maintenance. Well, the ecosystem underneath has changed a lot. .NET is changing towards .NET Core. C# is changing. XAML is changing. There are multiple environments with multiple different XAML engines now, and it becomes harder and harder for those open source frameworks to remain maintained. So Caliburn and Caliburn Micro disappeared. If you take a look at the lower right corner, you see that Laurent has merged his last pull request on the very popular MVVM Lite library almost 2 years ago now. So that's also a library that is not maintained anymore. Prism is alive and kicking, but on the other hand, if you look at the documentation in the middle of the slide, you see that there are differences in Prism for WPF Uno, for Xamarin forums, legacy platforms, there is version 6. Each technology stack has actually its own Prism framework. And if you are in a company responsible for multiple applications in multiple frameworks, you also have a different Prism with a different API in those environments. And that is not a fantastic situation, in my opinion. The good thing is that all of these frameworks are or were open source. And many developers, well, like me, have probably a homebrewed version of an MVVM framework that they use inside their applications. On the right, you have there an overview of a part of an application that I recently wrote. And you see there are views, there are view models, services, and models. But I also have my own MVVM namespace, with a couple of useful classes that I borrowed from those different frameworks. Bindable base from Prism, delegate command from Caliburn, view model base from MVVM Lite, and so on. And this is especially something that you see appearing in newer projects. Because as I mentioned, Prism is relatively big, and all of the rest is not maintained anymore. So if you build a big application that requires MVVM, developer teams are sometimes forced actually to brew their own version of an MVVM library. And that is not a fantastic situation. And I am very glad that Windows Community Toolkit comes up now with an MVVM library, the first one in many years that will be in the Microsoft namespace. As I mentioned, the new MVVM toolkit is part of the Windows Community Toolkit, which is a very big, in the meantime, it has grown into a very big library. It started in the Windows 8 UWP Windows Phone 8 days as a library with extra controls and helpers, wrappers around difficult parts of the difficult APIs like the composition engine and useful services like implementations of a Twitter service and Facebook service and things like that. Currently, there are a couple of highly used NuGet packages still part of that Windows Community Toolkit, and that is, for example, the Microsoft Graph controls and providers, the Lottie library with animated vector graphics, very cool package. There's a high performance package, which is very useful if you want to do memory management and multi-threading and do a lot with tasks, etc. And there is a lot more. And by the way, I emphasize the high performance package in this list because Sergio, an Italian MVP, did a lot of work in that high performance package, and it's also he is also the main developer for the Microsoft MVVM toolkit. So performance is very important for the new MVVM toolkit. The whole thing is part of the .NET Foundation, and there is an awesome sample app for the Windows Community Toolkit with a lot of very highly detailed examples and a lot of interactivity. You can change the XAML in the C# and immediately see the effect. It's a cool effort. But let's go to the Microsoft MVVM Toolkit itself. And I read from the documentation that the Microsoft Toolkit MVVM package is a modern, fast, modular MVVM library. It is modern and fast because it is written by it's written from the ground up in a modern way. It is platform as well as runtime independent. It is written against .NET standards 2.x. That means that you should be able to use it in Windows forums, WPF, UWP, MAUI, so the next version of Xamarin forums, UNO, and WinUI 3, the next version of Windows XAML. It is written in a UI agnostic way. That means that you could also use it. It's not written against XAML. You can also use it in Windows forums, etc. It doesn't impose architectural constraints on your applications. And it aims for compatibility with the popular MVVM library. So it tries to remain more or less compatible or provide a migration path from MVVM Lite to MVVM Toolkit. It is relatively new. It started a couple of months ago, and we are currently at preview 3. So there is not yet an official release. Let's take a look at some of the components. There are some observable base classes, different classes that all implement iNotify property change. There is the well-known relay command. There is a messenger. And maybe there is dependency injection. I put it between parentheses because the discussion is still going on. A couple of months ago, when I first saw that toolkit appearing, I decided to create a little sample app to try and test and compare the new toolkit with the library that I had from myself. And this is an application that we're going to use throughout this session. It is available on GitHub. Feel free to play with it if you want. Okay, let's take a look at the core classes, the different observables, and the relay commands. Again, this is the target of the core classes. Divide the components in three groups that almost automatically can communicate with each other. And in the MVVM component model namespace, there are three types of observables. There is the observable object class, observable validator, that's a brand new class that appeared in preview 3, and there is observable recipient that you may also know as a view model base in other frameworks. Observable object is the cornerstone of the MVVM toolkit. In other frameworks, it is known as bindable base or observable or notify property changed and things like that. It provides the default implementation of the iNotified property changed and iNotified property changing interfaces. So it allows change propagation and it enables data binding between views and view models. That's not so special. Every MVVM framework has that. What's special about MVVM toolkit is that there is support for properties of type task. And here we have on the right side the class definition with the property changed and property changing events, etc., and the well-known set property that we know from most of the other MVVM frameworks. We're going to dive into the sample up in a couple of moments. And the first topic of the sample up is superheroes. We're going to create an observable object of type superhero. Superheroes have a name, they have an enemy, they have their favorite tool, they have their favorite vehicle to travel with, they have their favorite assistant, and things like that. And they come also in different flavors. Depending on your data provider, you end up with different superheroes. What we see here is, for example, NBC and BBC that have two different heroes. But okay, if you go to Amazon or Netflix or Disney, you see different superheroes. And this is basically what we're going to play with. We start with a simple sample of an observable object. I switch to my Visual Studio. And here is the sample up, and we're going to building blocks. Over here, you see that I have loaded a superhero. That's Inspector Spacetime. His arch enemy is the Blorgons, and we are currently playing with the red phone box data provider. And with a click on that button over here, I'm going to update the enemy of Dr. Spacetime. Okay, it went from the Borgons to Gargamel, Lex Luthor, the Joker, Voldemort, etc. And under the hood, the observable object is doing all the work. Let's take a look at how things are implemented, and I'm pretty sure that there are no surprises here. I created a class superhero that inherits from observable object. I created fields and properties, and in the setter of the property, I call set property with a reference to the field and the new value. It is exactly the same in all the other MVVM frameworks, and this allows me to bind in a text block the name of the superhero to the text, for example. No surprises over here. What's special in MVVM toolkit is that there is task completion notification for properties of type task. Let's jump to Visual Studio again. And over here, what superheroes do is save the universe. That's a property of type task because it can take a while. Some superheroes can save the universe in 2 seconds, But sometimes it takes 13 episodes of 15 minutes to save the universe. Anyway, again, I'm going to update. And you see, task is now running. And okay, bad luck. Superhero lost his quantum spanner and the universe is lost. Let's click that again. And this is again just updating a property. And the only difference here is, okay, this time we are saved. I get a notify on completion of the task. Let's see how that works. Again, I have fields and properties. The property itself is of task of string. So it takes some time and then it returns a string. The field is defined as an internal class, the task notifier of T, in our case, a task notifier of string. And in the setter, instead of setting the property, I specify set property and notify on completion. And that's all I need to do. This is the definition of the Save the Universe task. In the superhero class, it's a new task that returns a string. It waits for 2 seconds and then it returns a value. And then later on, if I start that task, I not only update the property, but I also update the property when the task is finished. And that allows me to bind a text block here to the status of the task. Second class in the observables is the observable validator. That is an extremely useful class. It's an observable object that hosts a default implementation of the ancient .NET iNotify data error info interface. It allows view models and models to host validation rules and expose the result of validations. In the old days of Windows development, Windows Forms Controls and ASP.NET Form Controls and WPF Controls, they had an error template. And if they were bound to an illegal or an invalid value, they were decorated, for example, with a red rectangle around them or with an exclamation mark next to them. And if you hovered over that exclamation mark, you had a tooltip with the message that displays what went wrong. Now, the most of the modern XAML stacks don't have that anymore. So I notify data error info is less and less used, but there is good news. The UI part of the validator contract will be implemented in WinUI 3, the next version of Microsoft XAML. The interface itself is very simple, a little bit too simple, I think. There's a Boolean that says whether or not there are validation errors. There is an errors changed, and you can get the error messages for a property name or for the whole instance. That's all there is. Let's take a look at the scenario. We are going to build a study group. A study group is a group of students from a class that at regular intervals meet each other around a specific topic. There is a maximum size of a user group because, well, it's limited by the classroom that they have to sit in. And in our particular case, study groups also need to have hobbies. And one of the hobbies, rules of the house, should be paintball. Let's take a look at this in practice. And I jump again to Visual Studio to run a sample up. And here we have the observable validator. He's already not happy. Why? Because apparently the topic is required. So let's enter a topic. He's still not happy. The topic should be longer than one character. So make this Spanish. This is the year. Let's make that 2003. He's also not happy. Only 2009 to 2015 are valid. So let's make that 2014. Hobbies. Ping pong. And again, he's not happy. Hobbies should contain paintball. So let's make that ping pong and paint ball. Leave the field and up. We are happy. Let's see how that is implemented using that new toolkit. I created the class study group and it inherits from observable validator. So it not only implements I notify property change and changing, but also I data error info. And you see that again, I have just a couple of fields and properties. And you see that the fields are decorated with the well-known validation annotation fields. I can specify that the field topic is required. I can give it a minimum length. I can give it a maximum length. I can make sure it falls in a range. There are a lot of attributes available in this category, regular expression and things like that. There are attributes that allow you to compare the new value with the old value. There are attributes that allow you to compare different properties of the same object, if you want to compare a begin date versus an end date, for example. And if that's not enough, you can build very easily your own custom validator. But that has nothing to do with the observable validator. Those things exist and we're just reusing them here. What's special is for observable validator is that set property overload that has an extra boolean here, true. That means, okay, if the property of this field is assigned, then you should run the validation. That's what this means. I also decided to make my life for the life of the consumers of that object a little bit easier by exposing the errors as a property. I created the string errors, which is just a concatenation with a carriage return in between of the full list of validation errors for the whole object, which is what I display in the tooltip that you just saw. And I also decided that each time that the errors collection is changed, I change or I raise property change for that errors field. So that allows me to bind the text of the tooltip to the errors. And here's the rest of the class. In the constructor, I register the event handler that we just saw in the previous slide. I also decided that on each property change of whatever property, we also going to raise property change of has errors. So after each property change, my view will re-evaluate if there are errors or not, and then decide to show that warning or not. And in the view, it's very simple. Three text boxes, two-way bound to topic, class, and hobbies of the study group instance. And this is the control that shows a symbol if there are validation errors. Visibility is bound to the has errors property, true or false. And the tooltip displays the list of errors, which is a very easy way to do all of this. Next, base component of WCT MVVM toolkit is also a well-known one. It's the relay command, which is a default implementation of the I command interface that allows to call a method in a view model from an event in a view. If you click on a button, you actually execute a method on the corresponding view model. In other frameworks, this one is known as delegate command. So again, there is nothing special over here. You have an implementation of the interface with a constructor that takes the action, the reference to the method, and a Boolean function specifying whether or not the method can be executed. There's the execute, the can execute, etc. What's special in MVVM toolkit is that there is an asynchronous version available. Okay, let's switch back to our Visual Studio and run the relay command. What we're going to do here is basically switch the data provider. We're going to switch channel. If I click over here, you will see that a new data provider will be loaded. And as I mentioned earlier, a new data provider means a new superhero. So if I click this one, you see that Inspector Spacetime is gone and we are seeing Doctor Who now, whose nemesis are the Daleks. Indeed, I also see that my async button grayed out. If I switch again, it will come back. And I'm going to tell you in a couple of minutes how that works. And let's immediately do a demo on async. I'm going to now call an async method as a result of clicking that button. And that gives me some extra features. It allows, for example, to display a busy indicator. You see, if I click over here, you see the busy indicator running. How does it work? Nothing spectacular again over here. In my view model, I have the switch data provider command as a public property of type I command. And in the constructor or any other part of code, I assign that to a new relay command where I give a reference to the method that should be executed when the command execute is called. And the button has its command property bound to that command in the view model. And the same is true for the async version. So I have an async method. So I create a public field again, but this time of iasync relay command. And again, I assign that to a new async relay command with a reference to the async method that switches the data provider. And in this case, I also provide a function to indicate whether or not the command can execute. And apparently this command can only execute if the red data provider is the current one. And that's the reason that the button in the screen sometimes automatically grays out. On top of that, that command has an isRunning property, and I can bind my busy indicator, progress ring in this case. The isActive I can bind to the isRunning of the async command. And you see we have a pretty complex scenario involving not a single code behind syntax. Everything is done by using binding and by choosing the correct base classes for my components. Let's dive into the next component, the messenger. And as already mentioned, the messenger is an infrastructure that allows multiple view models and maybe other components to communicate with each other without being aware of each other. which is what I just said. Yep. It's also known as the publish subscriber pattern. So it allows decent communication among an arbitrary group of view models instead of them yelling next to each other and not listening to each other. I have again a small demo. Let's dive into Visual Studio and take a look at the messenger. So I have here a page with a couple of so-called modules, basically view model pairs, and they are not aware of each other. For the sake of the demo, they are sitting in the same page, but they could be spread on multiple pages and views on multiple monitors, etc. I just put them together for the demo. The application has a theme, again, red or blue, and the theme module here allows to change the theme. It sends a message, hey people, the theme changed from red to blue, or vice versa. The other modules, when startup, ask what is the current theme to instantiate themselves, but for the rest, okay, they are just listening to the message, hey people, the theme changed, and they react accordingly by changing background color or by changing a picture. And if you take a look in the down left corner in my Visual Studio, I also hooked in via dependency injection a logger to see who sent what message or who received what message. If I jump to another page and then come back and switch, you suddenly see that the memory leaking module here received the change to blue twice. And then again, if I switch to another page and come back, there are now three memory leaking modules listening because, well, under the hood, everything is built on .NET events. And that means you have to take care of memory leaks. The MVVM toolkit comes with a couple of built-in messages to support common scenarios. For example, the value change message of T and the request message of T. Okay, messages to indicate that something has changed in the application, and a message to require the current value. The base class for classes that can deal with the messenger is called observable recipient. So by definition, it is an observable object with a reference to a messenger. In other frameworks, it is known as view model base. And as you see, they have as a property a messenger, but also some extra things like is active and activated and deactivated. And again, overloads of set properties with a Boolean in this case. If I assign a new value to the properties, should I broadcast this immediately to everyone who's interested? Yes or no? The messenger itself, the iMessenger, is the thing that connects the senders and the receivers. It's also known as the event aggregator or event bus in other frameworks. And it has a send message over here in the middle, and then a register and unregister methods. And here's how that looks like in the code of the sample app. My shell view model, which is the view model of the shell of the application, inherits from observable recipient. The shell view model is the first one that is in instantiated in the application, and it is the one that is responsible for getting the initial theme. I use here theme.default, which is the red theme, I think, but in a real application, it would read this from the application settings. And that shell view model registers its interest in two types of messages. The theme request message, where it has a handler for. If somebody requires the current theme, I'm going to reply with the current value of the theme. The shell view model is also interested in being notified when the theme is changed by the theme module. And indeed, when it receives a theme changed message, it updates the value of the private field, and in a real application would also update the app settings. Sending a message is very easy. The view models just call messenger.send and the message type. Messenger send a theme request message and the return will be the new theme. The module that changes just calls messenger.send new theme change message, and it provides the new value. So under the hood, everything is glued together with .NET events. So that means you have to be aware of memory leaks. For every plus equals event handler in a class, you should always have a minus equals to unregister. And again, that messenger class comes with a couple of very useful methods for unregistering. Like, for example, unregister all, but you can also unregister for a specific message. There's also a very useful property called isActive that allows view models to temporarily respond to react to messages, namely only when they are active. And at the bottom, the view, it knows when it loads and unloads. It can say that the color view model in this case becomes active, and on unload, it becomes inactive. That view model registered its messages in the unactivated. So only when the view model is active in the view, it will now listen to messages. And the good thing is that if you use this pattern with if active false, under the hood, the framework will automatically, or the library will automatically, when is active becomes false, unregister all the messages for that view model. So there is an on deactivated, but it's not mandatory to implement it. So this is really useful to prevent memory leaks. By the way, a small performance tip, since version 3.0, since preview 3 of the toolkit, you can choose between two implementations of a messenger. The default messenger uses weak references. So eventually those color view models that we saw in the demo will be cleaned up by the garbage collector. But if you know that you did a good job on providing memory leaks, you can switch to the strong reference messenger, which is a little bit faster than the default one. There's also a useful feature in messaging that deals with tokens. And I have again a small sample from real life, as you see. In the academy, there is a war going on between two parties that build forts. One builds a pillow fort, the other a blanket fort. And since all the space is taken, the only thing that they can do to expand their territory is fight each other, and they start a war. War means casualties, so somebody creates a little hospital, and each time that one of the members of a party is injured, she takes care of it, and she also sends a message. Hey, application, there is a new casualty. And that could be a pillow man or a blanket man, of course. Now, the pillow mans are only interested in messages about injured pillow mans, and the same is true for the blanket people. So there are two groups here that are only interested in part of the messages of a specific type. Now, on the other hand, and we're at the last picture, there's also a very professional photograph that is interested in knowing all of the casualties. So regardless of the token, she wants to see the message. And let's switch over here to the application and go to Messenger with the token. The demo is shorter than the explanation. I have over here the modules, the Pillow Town module that is only interested in seeing pillow casualties. The Blanketsburg module is only interested in messages that have the blanket token. And there is the professional photographer that is interested in everything. And I have a small module that represents the hospital that reports the casualties. And if I register a casualty, you see that each time I click this button, a casualty message is sent with a particular token. I use the pillow token now, and you see that only these two are apparently reacting to that message. If I click the other button, you see that this module is only receiving this message, and the camera is also getting it. That's all there is. Let's see how that works. I defined a casualty message. That's just an empty message. It's good to see that no specific base class is needed for messages. And in the middle, you see the code that is behind the two buttons. Messenger.send a casualty message of string. And then you have the message and the so-called token, pillow or blanket. That's what the hospital is sending. And this is what the different parties use to receive messages with a specific token. So I do messenger, register, I'm interested in casualty message with a string token, and I'm interested here in the blanket token. So one module uses blanket over here, the other module types pillow over here, and we're done. I tried to be lazy. And for the camera module, I said, okay, I'm registering for casualty message and I ignore the token. Well, it doesn't work. If you don't provide a token, you never get tokenized messages. And okay, a small deviation here. If you take a look here at the token of type string, it's easy to type mistakes over here. So string might not be the ideal candidate for a token. I would like to see enums over there. Now, and unfortunately, you see that the token must implement iEquatable of token. And that means, sorry guys, no enumerations. Those of you who earlier today saw Peter Himschoot's session know how to build in a good way a value object that implement all of that and still look like enums. I have a quick and dirty implementation over here that, as I mentioned, is quick and dirty and incomplete, but at least it fits a slide. I created the class party, which implements iEquatable of party and hence can be used as a token for a message with two static fields, one named pillow and blanket. And over here you see that I nicely implemented equals. And now the code can be very much simplified. Instead of string and then hard-coded strings, I can send the casualty message with party as a token and use party.pillow or party.blanket in my code, which is pretty cool. Now, I hear you're thinking other frameworks also have that. I have here a screenshot of the Discord server that we use to talk with each other with a message from Sergio, the main developer of this toolkit. He ran lots and lots of benchmarks where he compared the new implementation of Community Toolkit MVVM with several other libraries like MVVM and Prism, etc. And as you see, the messenger, if you compare it to the one in Prism, which, okay, is one of the slowest, MVVM Toolkit is 36 times faster and uses 8 million times less memory. A lot of these benchmarks were done, and then we are continually monitoring the implementations over here and see if we are still fast. I also have to admit, by the way, this is a screenshot of preview 1 or 2, and it refers to the strong type reference messenger, not the weak reference type messenger. Last but not least, MVVM frameworks should have support for services. And okay, there's good news and there is bad news. In preview 1 and preview 2, the toolkit contained a simple IOC container. In preview 3, we kicked it out, but well, it might come back. You never know. I'm going to skip the demo over here because it has nothing to do with MVVM Toolkit per se. It only shows that we are very compatible with dependency injection. The question is still not answered. Should there be an IOC container in the toolkit? On one hand, it is extremely useful. If you want to reuse expensive view models, for example, it's good to have them available in a container. If you want to access the messengers from a view, which is not an observable recipient, then you should put that messenger available in an IOC container. Another reason why there might be need for a container in the toolkit is because we want to remain compatible with MVVM Lite, and MVVM Lite has a simple IOC container. Now, on the other hand, that Microsoft Extensions Dependency Injection NuGet package that you see there in the bottom, it's a very big DLL compared to the toolkit itself. So it might not be the greatest idea to add dependency to that package. On top of that, a lot of companies are already using other packages for dependency injection and IOC containers, things like Autofac, Ninject, Spring.net, Castle Windsor, and things like that. Anyway, I want to stop here showing code with a small sample of how you could build very easily a service provider. I did that in a partial class of the application, and I use the iService provider from this dependency injection, where when we start the application, I add a singleton of iMessenger in the container where I use the weak reference messenger, and this will allow views to call the messenger. I also took the decision that my color module view model is a very expensive one and it should not be thrown away each time that a view is unloaded. So we create a singleton and add it. We create an instance and add it in that service provider. And as you see over here, if someone needs the view model, you just call service provider get service. If a view wants to send a message, it says app service provider get service. Send the message. And we also support constructor injection. As you see, my color model view model, that's a hard word, has a constructor that injects the logging service and the dialog service. Okay, we are about to finish, but there is a lot more than what I have shown you. There is, for example, a beautiful sample app. That in a very detailed way introduces you to all the classes and their interfaces. And just like with the big community toolkit application and sample app, it allows for interactivity. You can change the XAML and see what happens immediately, which is, well, relatively spectacular. What I personally also find very spectacular is that that same code base, that same sample app runs in all the stacks. On the left, you see the same code. You see code running in UWP. In the middle, you see it running in Uno on WebAssembly, so in the browser. And on the right, there is that same source code, same API running on Android. Last but not least, the team is creating a migration guide from different platforms, and the focus is on MVVM Lite because that is the most widespread toolkit nowadays. So you will have a very detailed guidance on how to update your applications from MVVM Lite to the new toolkit. Okay. We're close to the end. As I promised in the beginning, I tried to convince you that WCT MVVM library is very useful. It is extremely fast. If you are into .NET client development, it will probably work in your applications, and you should consider it as a toolkit or a library, not an entire framework. Thank you very much for taking and listening. Thank you very much for the sponsors and stay safe.
Thank you, Diederik. There is a question in the Q&A.
Would you argue it's a good idea to swap out MVVM Lite for this framework in a WPF app in active development? And do you think it's worth the effort? Honestly, I think yes. It's a lot more modern. It's a lot more flexible on one hand, but on the other hand, the team is very high on trying to remain entirely MVVM Lite compatible or provide a very easy migration path to it. And it's pretty sure that MVVM Lite is 2 years old and will not be modernized and will have problems with the underlying ecosystem continuously changing, .NET, .NET Core, WinUI that you're going to use in WPF later on, and things like that. And the new toolkit will remain as MVVM Lite as possible, but will be adapted to that evolution. So yes, I think it would be a good idea even now to already swap MVVM Lite for WCT MVVM.
Are there any other questions for Diederik? I think we're good.
Okay, thank you all. Stay safe.
Thank you. So we have one session left, which will start right on this stage. So Bart Smet will be joining us directly from the US in 15 minutes on this stage. He'll be talking about C# 9.